y'all don't mind, let's go back to a time we really used to have church. We used to have a good time, praising the Lord, in spirit and in truth.
I love them old
church. That old brother, pick up that old hymn book and
singing,
you knew exactly what he was gonna say. Sisters got happy. Folks start patting their feet, clapping their hands, and all of a sudden, he break off in a song, something like this.
Sisters,
yes.
But for you to take this church on as your own, in attendance and support, financially, every way you can, tell your friends, tell your family members that you know a great place to come and learn God's word, and a great place to grow until the Lord comes back again. Amen. And we certainly watch God do a wonderful thing. I just want to see God move us to another level. We've been here for a while. It's time for us to move to another level. Time for us to experience the power of God. And I think it's going to start with you, at least every one of you. So if you don't use it like talking to people, talk to people. Tell people about Jesus. Amen?
Man.
Every one of us ought to have a story to tell people about Jesus, or our jobs, at home, our neighborhood, wherever we go, we ought to tell somebody about Jesus.
Man.
As a matter of fact, I want you to look at your neighbor right there and tell them something about Jesus right now. Something about Jesus. Jesus love you. Look at your neighbor and tell them something about Jesus. Amen. Amen. Praise God. Praise God. If you have any Bibles, just raise them high. Okay, if I raise them high. Amen. Amen. Bible church. Turn with me to Ephesians chapter 12. The Bible look good. Ephesians chapter 12. We're not even worried about that noise on the other side. We're going to praise God anyway. Amen.
Amen.
We can praise God anyway. And we want to look at Ephesians chapter 12, verse 26 through 31. Ephesians chapter 12, verse 26 through 31. Just say amen when you have it. Slow down, knock if you're still looking.
Amen.
Slow
down. We didn't hear what you said.
Amen. Ephesians chapter 12. Verse 26 to 31.
Okay.
Amen. Our Father. Amen. I read the tell me that. So that I know you with me, then you just be able to preach it. I was like, what are you talking about? We all get it. Amen. Little fellas, we got that Bible over there. Amen. Children are our future in the church, so we want to make sure we bring them up, teach them to young people. Time will come, we got to leave here. Buried my uncle last weekend, sad occasion, but you can see the younger Hamiltons coming along behind him. And the big wheel just keep on spinning. Death is never easy. It's always challenging. But I can tell you that God sure will comfort you, and he'll take you along the way. So everybody, first in chapter 12, very, very good text, verse 26. And through 31, that we're mostly going to focus. And I want to talk to you about a subject matter concerning the functionality of the church,
right,
and how God sees his church. If there was ever a church that needed to be reminded of its functionality, it was this church, the church of Corinth.
Right.
From the very beginning, chapter 1, chapter 2, we find that there's trouble in the church.
Yes.
Have you ever been to a church where there's trouble in the church?
Yes, sir.
Most of the time, we think of trouble in the church being something that somebody did something. This is a different kind of trouble. Mm-hmm. It's trouble with the psychosis of the church.
Yeah.
There is a belief that man somehow has some type of power or order in the church. Chapter 1, we find that Paul says that I received a letter from the house of Chloe.
Yes.
That he had received information that there was a young man in the church,
yes,
who wanted to sleep with his father's wife.
Amen.
He says in chapter 5 that boy is ashamed that,
yes,
one among the Gentiles, not as nasty as he.
Wow.
In this text, we'll find that there's power problems in the text.
Yes.
Those who God had gifted,
uh-huh,
in order to confirm his word. And that's all the miraculous gifts were. It was a time to confirm the word of God.
Yes.
Uh, have now been polluted, convoluted with man's idiosyncrasies. Because God is using them, they seem to think that they're somebody.
Well,
have you ever seen God halfway bless somebody and they lose their mind?
Lord,
you can't talk to them no more.
Yeah.
You walk to them, how you doing? I love them. How about you? And all that kind of stuff. And you try, how you doing? You can't talk to them no more. And they walk around talking about God is good all the time. All the time. God is good. And you sit down and eat and they walk around talking about, did you pray for your food? All kind of food. It was a time in which people had misconstrued of the power of God and had made the very thing that God left to bring the church together was used as a device now to pull the church apart.
Well,
when God allowed the gifts of the Holy Spirit, if you will, to be used by those men, not everyone had the gifts. And that's not my sermon, but I just want to make sure that you understand there are no speaking in tongues today.
Amen.
There is no modern day prophets.
Uh-huh.
If it was, he predicted that Hillary would win
yes.
a long time ago. Amen.
Amen.
He tells you that the lottery numbers are 6, 5, 15, and 32.
Well,
if there were prophets today,
uh-huh.
they would certainly be charging you at least $225 an hour. Amen.
Amen.
There are no prophets today. And in chapter 12, we find these talented and gifted people who need to understand that in spite of the sorcery in which they came from, that God has now brought Jews and the Gentiles into one church.
Yeah.
There is no more many different beliefs and animism and emperorism and all that stuff have now been done away with in the cross of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
And now God has set up in his church the things that he needs to confirm the powerful workings of the gospel until the Bible is complete.
Amen.
You remember that Jesus declared in John chapter 20, he says that these and many more things that Jesus do in the presence of his disciples.
Yes.
I like that these are written that ye might believe
yes,
that Jesus Christ is the Son of God. Well, preacher, what do you mean by that? The only reason that people were able to speak in tongues, the only that God used miraculous healings, the only that God brought about this miraculous manifestation was not for the will and power of men, was not to impress men, was not to heal folk that need to be healed. He brought about the miraculous age in order to confirm that these men were indeed his men. And that was the purpose, and that the Bible was right as it would come later. And whenever someone says, I'm doing a miracle today, I'm speaking tongues today, they're suggesting that the Bible is not complete. Because the Bible will teach you that God only allowed miracles until the Word of God was complete. And once the Word of God was complete, there will be no more miracles. This then strikes a chord to all the Thomas believers. Because the people of Thomas' faith only believe because they see it. But God said, bless those who don't see it. Bless those who don't need a miracle. But believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God because he says he's the Son of God. Y'all, I say amen. I don't need God to make Godzilla rise up out of the Pacific. All God got to do is just say a word. And I believe it. Y'all, I say amen. I don't need God to raise no dead folk that it might scare me. Amen. God raised some dead folk up. I'm going to everlast for y'all out of San Diego. Amen. I don't need no kind of miracle. If God raised up somebody dead, there ain't nobody to keep up with me. Amen.
Yes.
When we were talking at my uncle's funeral, he said that they said that we were at the funeral home.
Yeah.
And we went back to see our uncle, and we went back there, and we were standing there talking. One of the bodies raised up, and while they were still talking, I made my way across the street and up the hill. I don't play with dead stuff, amen.
Amen.
When they said a dead body moved this time, this time to go. I could never get a funeral home director because I don't know about you, but I got something going on here, didn't I? Amen. But aren't you glad that Paul
is better than the other. And you've been fighting on who has more clout. You've been fighting over who has more authority. You've been fighting over who's more right than the other. He said, let me tell you something. You fight over the wrong stuff. What you need to fight over is who loves the most. Amen. See, we have the right kind of fights in the church. Who can love God the most? God will get the glory. Y'all might say, amen. We've got to fight over who will love God the most to be here early and bring the preachers some donuts. Amen. We've got to fight over who loves God the most, who's going to sing the loudest till the sun will even fall. Y'all might say, amen. We've got to fight over who's going to pray the most. Give God glory and a chance together. I don't know about you, but I don't have fights about superficial stuff. But I'll tell you what, there's nobody that's going to beat me praising God, because God has shown up being good to me. God has been good to me. Can't you just lift your hands and shout right now, thank you, Jesus. I watch God work in Brittany's life. And I say this, and I mean this too. Brittany moved here some time ago, and we met her through a person with multiple personality disorders. And it said her name was Sebastian. And he introduced us, we met her, she was quiet, set her to the side, but what she didn't know is that she was struggling and she needed to get situated in San Diego. Amen. And I watched that child go from job to job and work and save her money and put her money up, and she said, Pastor, I'm up to such, I'm doing good. Keep on, you gotta have first leg. But this young lady, with the help of God, moved into her own place yesterday.
Amen.
Y'all I say amen?
Yeah.
Now, every brother in here that's still living with somebody, you need a woman.
All right.
Yeah. And you need a woman. You get something, you need a woman.
Amen.
This young lady, Bible, without no complaining, no whining, no crying. With the Lord, we prayed and God delivered, found her own place.
Amen.
And if y'all ain't hating, everybody ought to get some kind of gift just to say we want to sow into what God is doing for you. Here's a lamp, here's a pillar, here's something just to encourage you to keep your head in God's hand. Because God will bless those who diligently seek after Him. And it is no mistake that she was baptized the week before. She got her own place. Oh, y'all listen. She was baptized the week before.
Amen.
And then she gets on plates. And what God has said to her, that if you keep your head in my hand, and I work in you, you will accomplish a whole lot of stuff. But without me, praise God. The only reason you're struggling is because you think you're more gifted than God is able to give you in the first place.
Yes.
Here is the problem. And the title of my lesson this morning comes from verse number 26. When he said, verse 25, when he said that there shall be no schisms in the church.
Amen.
Well, preacher, what it mean? It said body. Well, the body is the church.
Yes.
And the church is the body.
Amen.
And Paul says, I'm right this left. And I mean to make it in modern day terms, because y'all didn't understand schisms, which defined schisma in the Greek to say heresy, falseness, separations, eruption, division in the church.
Oh, yes.
God hates division in the church.
Yes, he does.
Still can't understand what it means by schisms in the church.
Uh-huh.
Well, naturally it means that some part of the body is not functioning the way it's supposed to. Is not supported like it's supposed to, and it's causing the body to walk with a limp because there's a schism in the church. Still not getting wash your head. Right. Amen. And nothing right. Worse than a sneeze. Am I right? All the sneezer care about is themselves. Yeah. Sneeze don't care about them. They don't care about nobody else. All they care about is what they want, and they'll scheme, and they'll plot, and they'll do whatever they got to do to get what you got. And some of y'all messing with skeezers right now. Amen. Right. If you didn't give them the money, they don't want nothing to do. Shall I say amen now?
Amen.
So we can't have this type of maladaptive behavior in the church. But it says something after that, because the danger of having skeezers in the church, it is a person who lives in the old life and refuses to walk in the newness of Christ. You know right about it?
Yeah.
Didn't the Bible say in 2 Corinthians 5, verse 17, didn't the Bible teach her that if any man be in Christ Jesus, he's a new creation.
Oh, yeah.
Old things have passed away, and all things become new. Well, with a skeezer, you have to realize that they try to take old skin and put it in some new skin.
Yeah.
What's wrong with my Christian walk? You've been skeezing in the house of God. Am I right about it? You try to take half of you and put it to the new. Am I right about it? Matthew 9 and verse number 16. No man put up the new piece of material onto an old piece of glass. The new piece of rip the strands and make the hole bigger than it was when it started out. You can't take the old you and try to mess with the new you. You'll get schismatic results. There'll be a split in your life. And you'll be praying and talk to the devil on Monday and talk to the Lord on Tuesday. People tell me, come on over to my church, but you're down in VA hospital on Thursday night, big 23-21 night, down there playing Captain Jack Joe and San Diego Mad Dash, trying to fix 7-Eleven back down Little Joe, and then the next day you're talking about, thank you, Lord, for my winning down there. What's for you a schizer in the church? Have y'all say amen? Oh, praise God. Yeah. When we look at this great passage of scripture, we'll find that he is referring to that there should not be a division. There should not be a division in doctrine and lifestyle. There should not be any division in our attitudes. Lest that old part of us rip the church apart. The division is found in John 7 and verse 43, where the Bible said there was a big division amongst the people because of him. I want to stop by to tell you that even right now, the division about Jesus is that Jesus will accept any kind of worship that you put before him. The division about Jesus is that when Jesus says in Mark 16 and 16, and these signs shall follow them that believe, and my name shall they cast out devil, and my name shall they pick up serpents, and my name shall they drink any deadly thing, it won't hurt them. I'm right about it. And when we read in Mark, and he gave the people, not talking to us, he was talking to his apostles. Am I right about it? And if you think I'm a liar, just go pick up a rattlesnake and find out how fast you swallowed and try to put that snake. Y'all ought to say amen. Let me tell you something. I want to go to a church. There's one right here talking about they can do miraculous gifts. It's much better than we need a miracle right now.
Yeah.
You got four more dying with sugar diabetes. Yeah. And you should have been talking about TDJ can heal folk. Don't you know if TDJ can heal folk, nobody in the church would die of sugar diabetes? Don't you know? Don't you know if Creflo Dollar could heal folk? It cost you $1 million of healing. If he could heal folk, there wouldn't be any wheelchair. Do you understand the magnitude of the foolishness that you're allowing to come into your mind? You ought to be in a church that teaches the doctrine of Jesus Christ without a vision, without attraction, and hold on to God's unchanging hand. I don't need miracles to feel like I'm better than somebody. All I need to do is love God. The best that I can love God. But he says, you can't love me being divided. You can't be a skeezer and love me.
That's right.
Yeah, you can't sit up in the church house gossiping, talking about you love me. You can't both tear down the church and build up the church.
Yes.
You can't tear down yourself with all type of illicit use of drugs and yet try to build yourself up by communing with me at the time of communion. There must be a decision that there be no schisms in the body. Well, what is the body? Why did you mention the word body, Paul? Well, he said body, he was referring to the church. Am I right about it?
Yeah.
First Corinthians chapter 12 and around verse number 12. For as the body is one and have many members, and all the members of that one body be many of one body, so also is Christ. For by the one spirit we were all baptized into that one body. Am I right about it? hearts. God makes clear that he has a church. He refers to it as the body of Christ. But the body with too many heads is not the body at all. Body has one head, like your body has one head. But the problem is that there are too many people that want to try to be something that they are not.
Amen.
Paul says in the text that if the foot shall say because I'm not the hand, then I won't be a part of the body.
Yeah.
I'll stop by to tell you this. Whatever God puts you in the body, just do your part.
Yeah.
If he made you a foot, make sure you move us along in a direction in which the eyes are guiding you.
Yeah.
Because a foot without the eyes is simply a stub toe. Am I right about it?
Yeah.
Wherever God puts you, if he put you as a hand, be happy to be a hand.
Yeah.
I'd rather make the heaven as a hand than trying to take over the hand. Am I right about it?
Yeah.
God, wherever God puts you in the church, you ought to be glad that you're just in the body of Jesus Christ.
Yeah.
Because God knows what you do. And God didn't design the body for division. He designed the body to all work together. What could the foot do without the ankle? What could the ankle do without the knee? What could the knee do without the hip bone? What could the young God over talking? Come on, that's what I have. He made everything to do. And so we'd all work together. We'd all rejoice together. We'd be a team and move with one sound and one Lord and one faith. One hope about baptism. One God who's above us all, and through us all. One. And we might be one in Jesus Christ.
Amen.
So then, as we come and look at these Schisms, we find not only is it divisionist, but also is the absent mindedness to be thankful for what God has done for you.
Amen.
I don't know about you,
well,
but I'm so glad that God allowed me to find the truth
with
all these schismatic doctrines.
Mm.
I'm so glad that I can look out sometime and I see some foots acting like an animal